These are diagrams produced by a landscape ecologist, Richard Foreman at Harvard University, who in a very scientific way is analyzing the relationships between the organization, spatial organization of landscapes and the kind of life and species that they support. So this, again, this is an example of the way in which instead of going from culture to nature, we're going from nature to culture. Now, the other thing I think is that sort of emerged, again, it was a product of the thinking at the time. You know, remember, we're talking about early 1990s, the emergence of the World Wide Web, and these models of the kind of the connectivity that's happening now at a kind of virtual level, that in a way we can see the information exchange that happens in a landscape as similar to the kind of connectivity information exchange that's happening in the world of media. So going back, for example, to the famous Louis Kahn diagram that sees the city of Philadelphia as a system of flows that are channeled by the streets. I mentioned that with Jim Corder and myself, whenever we were doing projects, we always wanted to see the specific site, in this case, the landfill at Freshkills, in terms of the larger web of connections that would influence the site from outside, you know, including, for example, the flyover for species that are migrating from the southern hemispheres, who would stop over on the site. Oh, I keep doing that, don't I? Well, here we are. Process and change. So the perhaps the most important lesson from ecology and landscape for urbanism is this notion that sites don't have a fixed condition, that cities and landscapes are always changing, always evolving, and the landscape is in fact the product of change over time. The landscape that's produced by erosion. And of course, landscapes change with the seasons. This is Ashland Woodland Cemetery. I keep doing that. So to see the landscape as caught up in a continual process of change and adaptation, this was a diagram from the Freshkills project that talked about sort of, again, seeding the site, and that this was a recognition that the south and the west sides of these artificial hills in the landfill would have a different kind of species and spatiality that could emerge over time, whereas on the north and the east you could grow denser trees and so on, so that an undifferentiated landscape would become differentiated over time. Okay. So the last of these working propositions, and again, the other thing, you know, I just want to reiterate, I didn't think these up beforehand and then put them into practice. These are concepts. This is post-theorization. This is having worked on these large-scale projects, saying, okay, what are the kind of working propositions? And the last is this idea of the thick 2D, that if architecture works in a sense by vertical stacking and the kind of tectonics of section, landscape is kind of woven together, that essentially landscape unfolds in a kind of horizontal direction. You know, think about Central Park as a large, expansive, horizontal condition, but locally, what makes Central Park work is a very shallow section, you know, a question of 3 or 4 meters, where different pathways are woven under and over. And certainly from a kind of biological perspective, again, if you look at a meadow, it appears to be a kind of horizontal thing, But you have to zoom in and see that this intricate section, that's what makes the meadow function, right? And of course, you know, this is the famous rhizome, right, that Deleuze and Guattari talk about. But in fact, a rhizome, in fact, is a biological system that knits things together under the soil. So that idea, again, you know, you take something like a clover leaf, it's that 3 or 4 meters of separation that makes the system work, the way that things are kind of woven together. So that idea of working neither with the pure horizontality nor the sectional organization that we associate with architecture, but with this kind of thick 2D that belongs specifically to landscape and landscape urbanism. So, during this period, and I'm actually not going to show those projects, but during the period that I was the dean at Princeton, the partnership with Jim Korner broke up around 2002. I worked independently, doing, as Emilio mentioned, large-scale urban and landscape projects, many of which were in Asia. But also, as landscape urbanism evolved, I became somewhat critical of the potentials of landscape urbanism. In part, if we think about the way that cities are growing and changing today, is it really possible, as Kohlhaas proposed in the 1980s, to control the city with the void? That somehow the explosive growth of cities worldwide was simply not going to be controllable with the tools of landscape and landscape urbanism. And that's what led to initially a conference in 2009 that I organized at Princeton, which was really about, and you can see the people who were involved there, was really about saying, okay, there are all of these important lessons that we can learn from landscape urbanism, but let's take those lessons and bring them back to an architectural agency, to the agency of the building. You know, there are two, let's say, somewhat unfashionable, at least in the American context, unfashionable words in the title of this book. It's about form and it's about building. So it was really about bringing those discoveries that I just laid out with landscape urbanism back to the context of architecture. And looking, I mean, I just have come from Peru, so this idea of the landform building that in Machu Picchu, that there's hardly any distinction between the construction of the landscape and the construction of the building. And of course, you know, you go back to these historical examples, the construction of the kind of artificial mountain, all of these ways in which Eisenman's project in Santiago. But I would also say, to some degree, the book was also meant to kind of enlarge the discussion beyond the notion of landform building as the kind of softly rounded mound that you see here. And again, these, I mean, in some sense, if we understand the value of the Yokohama port terminal as a kind of artificial landscape that can loosely accommodate all of the complex programs of the terminal, it seems to me there's a certain amount of frustration with a building like this, and of course you could find many, many examples from that time period of this section, that this was, I think, the ambition to take the continuous connectivity of horizontal landscape folded up into a vertical building for the city. But of course that continuity can only ever be a diagram. At the end of the day, in fact, it's actually really partitioned as floors, despite the apparent continuity that the diagram is proposing. So I think, I talk about a shift from the biological to the geological, that architecture's character is more mineral than it is biological. And examples like this famous one, the Villa Malaparte, There's this famous story about, of all people, Field Marshal Rommel visiting Malaparte at his villa. Malaparte, as you may know, was a fascist sympathizer. And Rommel asks Malaparte, did you buy the house as it stood, or did you design and build it? And Malaparte's response was, I bought the house as it stood, and I designed the scenery. Which, of course, was a lie, but it tells you something about the quality of the house as it, again, as a kind of extension and completion of the landscape, but an extension and completion of the landscape that doesn't, in a way, try to imitate the forms of landscape. It works with a hard, rigorous architectural vocabulary to transform the landscape. Concrete bomb, you know, again, you know, as a kind of image of the geological. So just a number of these examples. So again, in an effort to open up the concept of landform building, we propose four different categories: form, scale, process, and atmosphere. Form, in other words, buildings whose form imitates natural formations, geological formations, artificial mountains. So the Monet Peirce Hall, for example, he talks about the auditorium having more to do with the geological context than the urban context. Let's see, Tugnon, Giancarlo Mazzanti in Medellin, and the idea that in the kind of tough urban context of Medellin, you need the kind of, he talks about this as kind of geological intervention. And then, of course, operating again at the scale, using Kenneth Frampton's notion of the megaform, project like Stephen Holzbanke Center, a kind of horizontal skyscraper that proposes a different relationship between the building and the ground, operating in this very large kind of horizontal structure. Dominique Perrault in Seoul, he has a kind of carving into the ground and creating this large void in the city. And one of our projects from that period of time, again, proposed this very long bar that would adapt to different conditions. But again, in this effort to think beyond the imitation of the forms of nature, to think about architectural spaces that become so large that they start to function as exterior public spaces. So the famous example of the Faculty of Architecture in São Paulo, Villanova Artigas, where those relationships between inside and outside get complicated. You know, you're inside the building, but you're also outside of spaces that are within space. There are spaces within spaces that complicate and create these larger scale spaces that then also, I think there was another, again, a kind of proposition here, which, you know, this photograph in which is the protests at the school, that the architecture itself forms a series of platforms. This is a little bit what I was talking about when I say that it offers different models for programmatic occupation. That there's a certain idea that these large-scale surfaces are available to be appropriated by collectivities that come in and use the space in ways perhaps that it wasn't initially intended for. So, you know, it's again, it's the idea that the way you occupy and move through this building is more like the way you occupy and move through a piece of landscape than it is the way you occupy and move through a conventional piece of architecture. The atriums of John Portman, for example, or the atmospherics that are so characteristic of the work of Sana, and later then of Ishigami, where you're uncertain of the specific boundaries of space. There's not a kind of division of space so much as there's a kind of gradation of spatial distinctions within a piece of architecture. So, you know, in a way, it's like being in a forest and being uncertain about the specific limits of the space. So in other words, to see this as a kind of landform phenomenon is to get beyond the notion of simply imitating the forms. And then also to ask the question, if you're going to be constructing these forms, what are the mechanisms, what are the technical mechanisms that you use? So we had a contribution from Fabian Schurer of the consultancy Design to Production that was responsible for actually constructing the surfaces of Sana's Rolex Center. So instead of sort of understanding this building, you know, simply as a series of undulating surfaces, to really look at the technology and the materiality involved in constructing these smooth surfaces. So to understand, for example, you know, the immense amounts of reinforcement, for example, necessary in order to create that smooth, continuous surface. So to pay attention to the, again, to the materiality of the surface in this particular case. So and again, I suppose as a kind of nod to the this is Rainer Banham in the Salt Flats in the American West, that sense of the expansive space of the American West, underlining some of this. Okay, so the last piece, I told you I would take the event, fill up the time if you give it to me. But again, I mean, it's meant to be a kind of pedagogical lecture, less. So there's a certain moment at which these field conditions ideas that had evolved through landscape urbanism, landform building, you know, it's not something that I would consciously come back to, you know, simply for the sake of having some sort of continuity of ideas. But if a problem is presented to me that seems to be solvable by use of these sort of field conditions ideas, it's something that, you know, sort of, let's say, belongs to my skill set, my set of tools. So when we were selected as one of 12 architects for the American Pavilion in the Venice Biennale last year, the theme for all of the architects in the American Pavilion was this idea of the architectural imagination as directed to specific sites in the city of Detroit. And we were assigned to look at the Packard plant, which is a large factory complex designed by the American architect and engineer Albert Kahn, beginning in 1919 and continuing right through the 1960s when it was taken out of service. But of course, Detroit, again, in the American context, presents a very particular urban problem. A city that at one time, very, very dense, very vital, an economic engine for the United States, which has, because of the various processes of suburbanization, the vitality of this scene from the 1920s has, all that energy has gone out to the suburbs, again, the kind of expansiveness of the city. It's interesting, this photograph from the 1920s, you have trolleys, you still have horse-drawn carriages, and you have hardly any cars, and of course you have a kind of robust architectural fabric, and then you have a city that is totally designed around the car. One form of transportation dominates, and the space has been dispersed, and architecture becomes secondary. And of course we all know what's been happening to Detroit. Actually, the center remains relatively intact with large-scale office buildings, but the residential fabric of Detroit has just been completely emptied out. They've lost huge numbers of population. They have huge problems with schools, with racism, with poverty and crime, and it's a serious problem. What to do with a city like Detroit? Of course, one of the interesting phenomena is that as the city has emptied out, nature has sort of returned, both in a kind of informal way, you can see the green and the trees, and then in sort of small-scale community activism and interest in things like sort of urban farming. So we were given this monstrous artifact, 20 million square feet of abandoned factory space. One of the only reasons that it's still intact is that Albert Kahn's brother was an engineer, and in the 19-teens, he invented a particular form of reinforcing, the Kahn bar system. And it turns out that this building was built so robustly, it would have been more expensive to tear it down. So it remains as this kind of elemental architectural artifact. So we wanted to understand it in its larger context, to see Detroit again as a large scale urban phenomenon. This is our site here, and we did a number of these kinds of studies and mapping. And the first thing we realized was that it really would have been impossible to make a successful proposition for this site, thinking of it purely within its kind of local context, the kind of new urbanist idea of a 5-minute walking radius. 5 minutes walking doesn't get you anywhere in this empty, expansive field of Detroit. Even a bicycle doesn't help you very much. So we realized we had to make larger scale connections. We had to connect out beyond the city, taking advantage of the existing infrastructures. Now, there's another important point, which is that Detroit, of course, has become a kind of locus of poverty and racism and urban problems. But the metropolitan region of Detroit is actually the fifth wealthiest in the United States. So we wanted, in a way, to sort of capture that region-wide wealth, pull it back into the city. At the same time, we could create a kind of local node. So this idea of a kind of self-contained urban node that would be connected to the infrastructure was really very important to thinking about the project. So we connected directly into the expressway and created a distribution system, really treating this sort of elemental architectural artifact, structural artifact, as a kind of series of urban platforms that could be occupied by multiple programs over time. So this is the plant itself. You can see this sort of organization in fingers had to do with the daylight factory, and of course the condition that we found it in as a complete ruin, totally cut off from the city around it, but with this incredible architectural quality as a kind of elemental structural artifact. And that was really what we wanted to preserve, that sense of a kind of series of platforms. So instead of the finger organization, we actually filled in. We actually increased by 50% the amount of area. Kind of counterintuitive. Project is too big, we made it even bigger. But in doing so, we created larger horizontal surfaces. So from this kind of finger organization, again, we create a kind of horizontal platform and a kind of field-like organization. So from fingers to a kind of mat building with the multiple surfaces that are porous, and then that allows us to, again, to think of this not so much as a building, but as an urban fragment that contains many, many different programs. Now, there's another important idea. This is a photograph of the factory when it was producing automobiles. You know, the serial production of cars. We wanted to kind of turn that around and say, okay, we have produced a kind of catalog of potential small-scale architectural artifacts that are laid out here on the model in the exhibition, and all of these go into here. But the particular way in which they're ultimately configured isn't necessarily fixed. So we have this sort of catalog, furniture, objects, buildings, and monuments, the texture that was laid out here on the model, that then can get reinserted here. But you know, I mean, literally, when we were doing this in the studio, we had no fixed plan that we were working to. It was really just the kind of accumulation of pieces over time. And the idea that the particular configuration that we ended up with was only one of many possible configurations. So here you see that sort of field conditions idea coming back 20 years later as a particular solution to a particular kind of urban problem. So here you see the ramp, here you see the array pieces, and the different collection of programs there. Now, so that, in a sense, is a kind of open-ended model, but we thought it was very important to have something that would give a kind of overall identity to the site and serve to organize this array of small-scale programs. And so we thought, what could organize this site within Detroit? What could give it a kind of identity? Would it be more about nature? Would it be a kind of cultural institution? Could it be very kind of commercial? Think about, you know, an office park or something there. And the solution that we proposed was the idea of a vertical botanical garden. In part, thinking about the kind of history of Detroit and this emergence of kind of informal urban farming culture, so that we would piggyback on that direction that already existed, and of course the architectural opportunities that turning this into something more architectural, more vertical would allow. So this is the ultimate sort of programmatic array, the large scale identifiable monuments, series of green interventions, fields, orchards, and gardens, the infrastructural system that distributes and connects into the infrastructure, and then the field array and the platforms. So these, again, just a couple of photographs of the final model, where you see the larger scale architectural interventions that are associated with the botanical garden program. These are experimental greenhouses, for example, but then you see the kind of looser, more open-ended arrays that we would hope would develop over time. This was an aviary that was proposed, and here you see the section with the existing factory architecture and the new interventions coming down from above, the idea of a kind of experimental agricultural station. So it is a project, for me at least, that brought together the thinking about infrastructural urbanism, landscape urbanism, and field conditions, and land for building. It's a very recent example of the work that we've completed. So you thought you were finished. One short coda, which changes scale completely. But I want to show, again, I think it's important for an architect to work at multiple scales, not only for the condition of the scale, but also different time scales, that smaller projects that happen more quickly, you know, again, this isn't a project for exhibition, but, you know, if it were, I mean, we, in our, I think maybe here, no, well, we, all of our final drawings, we said this is Detroit in 2045, recognizing that if this were in fact a project that were implemented, it would be implemented over a very, very long and very, very slow time scale. So I just show you a couple of the smaller scale works that unfold parallel to this. Tracing in a way a kind of preoccupation. This is a house that was built actually quite a while ago. It was among a group of about 20 architects asked to do houses in eastern Long Island. And the brief from the client said something like that they wanted some relationship to the local vernacular and more or less traditional roof lines, which we took to be a code word of no flat roofs. And actually it was for us, I think, a good opportunity to think about that idea And it goes back, I think, in part to my education with John Haydick. The figure of the building in the landscape as something, as a kind of profile against the sky, which has become something of a kind of preoccupation, particularly the sort of the form of the pitched roof, the shed roof that belongs to, well, not only American vernacular architecture, but really architecture, vernacular architecture all over. So this house was built, oh, I don't know, 20 years ago, but you see the recognition of the traditional form of the chimney, some sense of the kind of pitched roof, and the use of kind of materials, the cedar siding, that would tie it back to the local vernaculars of Eastern Long Island. So this house has turned out to be a kind of interesting reference for me. Also informed some of the larger scale work. This is a project I showed last time I lectured here, which was based on the aggregation of a pentagonal form in plan. So the sort of part to whole relationships. Let me see, it's hard to see, but look at that piece right there. This is an addition to a house that I did shortly after we didn't win this competition, so we decided we would build a piece of it. Around 2000, I built this very simple kind of horizontal, and then was given an opportunity to add on to it. The client is an artist, it's her studio, but we also changed the entry and the whole relationship to the landscape. So creating this sort of upper and lower courtyards, entry piece, and that's the studio. And then here you see it from below, the garage under the studio, and vertical access here. And this has sort of triggered a kind of preoccupation with this sort of iconic form of the building against the landscape. These are crystallography studies from a German geologist from the 19th century. This is about 6 months production of study models working at really at different scales with these kinds of formal configurations. And a lot of this work is playing out north of New York City in the Hudson River Valley. So there is a kind of the Hudson River School of 19th century American painting, the first, in a sense, specifically American art form that talked about this relationship between man and nature in the context of the American continent, to really try and think about the nature of the place in terms of these recent projects, some of which are quite modest. This is a studio for another studio for a painter that, you know, as you can see, it's almost like a big barn. The studio is next to the graveyard, and you can see this is a very simple structure with only a few kind of architectural moves. Another studio project in a kind of larger complex here, sitting at the edge of a field. And significantly, so this preoccupation with a pentagon in plan, it turns out that this little Monopoly house figure, that of course is a pentagon, it's a five-sided figure. So the idea with this house, the conceit, if you will, is that you have the allusion to the sort of archetypal house form, both in plan and in elevation. Very simple. You enter here, there's a spiral movement up the stairs, and then a kind of loft area. So here you see it in context on the edge of the field. And because the ridge line is not coincident with the plan geometry, even though it's just a very simple pitched roof, it creates a certain degree of geometric complexity. This is that stairway up, and creates a kind of dynamic space under the roof itself, and then always open to the space down below to avoid that sort of vertical partitioning of the space. And here you see it at the edge of that field. Now, for the Chicago Biennial, which is up now, if anybody is traveling in the US, we wanted to, on the one hand, think about the production of this kind of work that works with the kind of vernacular pitched roof, but also the construction system that is typical of small-scale work in the United States, the balloon frame construction that was invented in Chicago in 1830. The balloon frame is important for a number of reasons. It represents the beginning of the industrialization of building in the United States. It was based on pre-cut dimensional lumber and machine-made nails, and it replaced the heavy timber frame that had come before. Timber frames required sophisticated joinery, but balloon frame could be built by unskilled labor. And it also, Vincent Scully talks about the balloon frame in the context of his discussions about the shingle style, for example, that he sees these taut, thin skins of the balloon frame as something particularly American that, you know, you see later, for example, in the work of somebody like Venturi. The idea that the timber frame gains strength from the dimension of the members itself, the balloon frame gains strength from the repetition of many small members, and then the condition of the skin itself, which gives lateral stability today with plywood. So the balloon frame is actually very important in the history of Chicago. Chicago in the 19th century was the primary center for lumber production in the United States. So the timber that was harvested in northern Michigan and Wisconsin brought down to Chicago by water and then processed. Companies like Weyerhaeuser that makes plywood initially started in Chicago. And the other important thing with the balloon frame construction is you could take the pre-dimensioned lumber, you could put it on a rail car, send it out to the west that was beginning to be opened up. So the balloon frame was incredibly important for the opening up of the prairies for agricultural settlement. The forests in northern Michigan and Wisconsin were actually decimated by the logging. So it's a really interesting example of standardization and industrialization, architectural development in relationship to large-scale regional ecology. So the kind of opening up of the Great Plains for farming was in large part dependent on the invention of the balloon frame and the ability to build houses and stores and barns across the Great Plains. So we were very interested in that and wanted to kind of work with those balloon frame tectonics and then also this question of sort of part to whole relationships that goes back to my interest in field conditions. So we took, these are some of the study models for the studio. We took that basic configuration and started multiplying it to create something that would be a kind of small-scale collective. So could be a Grange Hall, could be a school. It wasn't really necessarily specified as program, and created this large-scale model for the exhibition. A kind of Schwassy axonometric model where you look at it from below, and so you understand the relationship between the balloon frame and this taut, thin skin that Scully has identified. And then, of course, it sits on a one-to-one fragment of the balloon frame construction. So you have this play between the model and the real installation. This is the installation in Chicago. And then the montage here, we wanted to sort of put the building back into context, and we created this photo montage of the small-scale aggregation in this kind of Great Plains landscape. And I don't know if any of you know a project, again, thinking about the specificity of the Chicago context, a project of Stanley Tigerman's from the 1970s for the Black Barn. So this was our homage to Stanley Tigerman as a kind of central figure in Chicago today. Another exhibition project, we were invited to do an installation, And rather than present drawings, we wanted to construct a full-scale installation in the gallery. And we worked with some configurations that had been worked out with the previous project, where, again, within this kind of single form, you can find six small houses embedded. So those are multiplied. So you end up with something that is both singular and multiple at the same time, which was, in relationship to the initial studies, was built as a one-quarter full-scale installation in the gallery. So it's an object that's almost sort of too big for its space, which then was later reconstructed. So it is an object in the field, and allowed us to get a better series of photographs. And you know, you can see, again, this ambiguous relationship of the scale. It's too big to be an architectural model, too small to be an actual house. So that sort of weird ambiguity we kind of liked with that project. But those same experiments are being translated into specific field projects. Last two projects, I'm going to just show very quickly, are two projects that are under construction right now. This is a studio for an artist in the mountains in Virginia. And the other is a house for some art collectors in the Hudson River Valley. So, again, I think you see very clearly here this continued preoccupation with the sort of archetypal pitched roof form and the way it can be combined to both undercut its singularity a little bit, yet keep some relationship to its sort of iconic power. Now, the site slopes quite steeply. And the premise of the project is very simple: to use the foundation walls as retaining to create a kind of precinct so that we have the private space of the studio and an open work yard, and then to drop the pitched roof forms over that. So the reinforced concrete right from the formwork, concrete board, and corrugated metal roofing. So there's a kind of variation of textures within a kind of monochromatic palette. So here you see the space, again, very simple, large open space, the studio services and the workyard. And in the US, we have to insulate the concrete walls, but that allows the kind of continuity. And you know, for a studio, this is what you need, just large, white, tall, white walls and good lighting. So very simple project, but working again with a particular relationship to landscape and the reiteration of that play with the one and the many and the use of the archetypal pitched roof form as a way to, again, to connect back to the local vernaculars of the site. Now, this is an interesting project. I did not design this house. I kind of wish I had. This was a self-built artist studio. Built sometime in the 1980s, we haven't been able to track. There was an architect, you know, it's this sort of strange mixture of John Haydock and Aldo Rossi. The construction is totally irrational, by the way. Makes no sense at all. These columns, in fact, are not structural. It's owned by some art collectors, and they asked us to sort of expand the size of the house, create more space for the collection, and a new bedroom. So we did a lot of studies, again, with this preoccupation with the figure of the building, but we realized that there was plenty of figural energy in the existing house, and what we really needed to do was simply to make a very simple form that would emphasize the figural quality of the building that already existed. So this is the project that we're developing. At the ground floor, we doubled the size and create a very long, continuous wall for exhibition space, and it's really unifying the space. It was an almost kind of surgical operation. We had to remove columns and insert steel beams in order to create that open space there. And then on the upper level, what had been divided into bedrooms becomes a large open gallery space and a very luxurious bedroom and bathroom for the clients with views out over the landscape. So the project's still under construction, but you can see the volumes and you can see the relationship between the new volume differentiated by material in relationship to the existing. And you see the way in which we leave the kind of iconic identification of the project to that existing building. So just a few shots of this under construction, and here you see the kind of north light to what was the artist's studio, which will now become the gallery, and the way that this addition is simply, in a way, deferring to the interesting qualities of that existing house. So that's a quick little coda that maybe underscores the idea that actually I don't think that an architect should do only one kind of work. Particularly in my case, with the strong kind of academic connection that allows me to continue to pursue projects at the urban scale under a kind of research umbrella, speculative design projects, but then not to underscore the importance of the smaller scale work where you have the satisfaction of construction. So, thank you very much.